Never early, never late. He gon' stand by what he claimed. Lived enough life to save.
I heard your heart, I see your pain. Out in the dark, out in the rain. Feel so alone, feel so afraid. I heard you pray in Jesus' name. It may be midnight or midday. It's never early, never late. He gon' stand by what he claimed. I lived enough life to save. Help is on the way. Sometimes it's days, sometimes it's years. Some face a lifetime of falling tears. But he's in the darkness, he's in the cold. Just like the morning, he always shows.
He always shows.
It may be midnight or midday. It's never early.
Welcome to Parkview Christian Church. We do have a special announcement, a couple today. One you can see there on the screen, so happy anniversary to Brad and Madonna. We also have a little clip from yesterday, Sarah and Bill Carr, that we wanted to share with you. Okay. And also, we want to remind you, and we'll mention it again at the end, but today is a great celebration for our body here at Parkview, and we are having a cookout, and you don't need to bring anything. Just come after church over there and see the new floor. Our hope is that God just uses this floor for his glory, so if you have time and are able, we would love for people to walk around on it and maybe even pray for the new floor, that God could use it. So just take some time to walk through the building and pray for God's will to be done there. So we're looking forward to that. So we invite you to stand with us this morning and worship together.
I heard an old, old story, how a Savior came from glory.
Healing. so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life.
Come, all you weary, come, all you thirsty, come to the well that never runs dry. Drink of the water, come and thirst no more.
Yeah. like the sound of a symphony to my ears. It's like holy water on my skin. Your forgiveness is like sweet, sweet honey on my lips. It's like the sound of a symphony to my ears. It's like holy.
Praise you. We thank you for the things that you're doing in this body here at Parkview. God, we thank you for the things that you're doing in our individual lives. God, you are so good to us. We lift up your name today. It's in your holy and powerful name that we pray, Jesus. Amen.
Being here today, we realize that we've come together because we have a common belief, a common bond, something that Jesus has done for us. While we know He lives for us today and He intercedes for us, there was one thing that had to happen before all that could take place even now, and that was His death. The Lord's Supper itself, we recognize His death. During the Lord's Supper and Jesus giving it to His disciples and telling them when He took the bread and when He took the fruit of the vine, take, eat. All of you drink of this. when he said, "This is my body and this is my blood," in that context, even though previous to that in the evening in that upper room, he had talked about his resurrection, in that context with the Lord's Supper, he didn't talk about the resurrection. He talked about his death. It was that sacrifice that was going to make everything else possible. And we remember that together today. Perhaps because what we have together is the sharing of even the dying of ourselves. That the old man of sin is crucified with him. That we do raise to walk in newness of life. And so in the process of remembering his death, we remember ours. So let's join together in that. Looking to make sure that our life is right with him. Remembering what he did to make that possible. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for Jesus. Thank you for his life. Him coming here for us. And we thank you for his sacrifice. His body and his blood being offered up for us. Father, I'm sure our understanding level of that is so limited to what it entails and the planning and the work of creating everything to make that possible. But Father, we know the simplicity that you have shared with us, that he bought us back, that he redeemed us, that he has set us apart through that sacrifice, that he has made us family. So Father, together we do this, remembering his body, remembering his blood, remembering him on that cross. We pray that you'll bless it. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Emmanuel.
Good morning. Good to see everybody here, and for those that are joining us online as well, we're glad that you can be with us as well in that fashion. We'll go ahead and continue on with communing together by having prayer together for anything that anybody needs to mention, maybe some praises, maybe some requests. And so we'll open it up now, wait for the microphone so that people watching online can hear the request as well. So we'll open it up for that this time. We have a couple back here.
I talked to Linda Shelton, and she's doing fine, but she goes back to the doctor Friday to see about when her radiation will start.
Okay, all right. So let's continue to keep Linda in our prayers, but praises for things going well so far. Others? Over here, Maddie's got one.
Pray for Alexandra, and she have a hard time to help pain and divorce, so just keep her pray.
Okay.
Her friend Alex.
Okay, yeah. Alex, yeah. So let's keep Maddie's friend in our prayers with that.
I had two more. Went swimming this week for Kyler and Shaiyu in Central Asia, so that's exciting. Plus, they're packing up, so we need to pray for them to be ready to leave, which is going to be really bittersweet.
Really tough, yeah. Yeah, that's right. So let's be praying for them in their transition and how that works out. Leroy.
We have a nephew that is in the hospital with a bowel, and they're having trouble with unblocking it and hope they don't have to operate, but he's been there about 6-7 days now.
Okay.
South Cox.
Okay, all right, so let's be praying for him with all that going on. John, you have some up there?
Radonna's got Colleen Riley and Burton Dennis and all the graduates.
Okay, all right. Remember them as well. I know there's going to be some traveling going on this week. I think later in the week, Nancy's going to be traveling. I'm going to be leaving on Tuesday and I'm going to go get my wife back. So, yeah, me too. Any others? All right, let's pray. Father, thank you so much for allowing us to come before your throne. Father, to worship you together. Father, even as we approach in this fashion, we're just thanking you and praising you for all that you have done for us, all the blessings that you've given to us. And Father, we just pray that these that we've mentioned, Father, some things that we can rejoice in, other things that we're looking for your intervention and your provision for. And Father, we lift these up to you with confidence that your will be done. And Father, knowing that you desire to hear ours and to have us express these things to you as well, even in the growth of your kingdom and just our realization in some cases, Father, of the need for you, Father, to respond to these requests. We realize maybe what it takes is for us to be ready to receive that. And so, Father, we express these to you, longing for certain things in each one of these circumstances, but, Father, knowing that you will know best for the growth of your kingdom, for those coming to you, that will last for eternity and not just temporary things that are going on here. And so, Father, while these weigh on us in various ways, Father, we lay them at your feet.
We trust you, and Father, we pray for the help to respond in all the right ways, whether it be because we get the answer that we are seeking, or whether it be learning how to deal with the things that we may not want to. But Father, we pray your kingdom will grow from all of it, even through our response, that people will see your glory, they will see your light in us, regardless. Father, again, we thank you for Jesus, for your Holy Spirit, for your word that you have given us through them. And Father, we just pray as we look into it this morning that you bless that time and that we gain from it something that we need even for the week to come. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. If you want to be turning to the 8th Psalm, Psalms 8. Actually, it wouldn't be Psalms 8, it would just be Psalm 8. But we do call it the Book of Psalms, so if you're referring to the book, but it is the 8th Psalm, and we'll read this first. It's short. We'll read it first, and then we'll go back and we'll talk about it a little bit and bring in some other passages that will hopefully help an understanding of what it's saying, though it's not that hard to understand. Beginning in verse 1, and I'm reading from the Christian Standard Bible this morning. Thought I'd switch it up just a little bit. It says in verse 1, Lord, our Lord, how magnificent is your name throughout the earth. You have covered the heavens with majesty. From the mouths of infants and nursing babes, you have established a stronghold on account of your adversaries in order to silence the enemy and the avenger. When I observe your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have set in place, what is a human being that you remember him, a son of man that you look after him? You have made him little less than God and crowned him with glory and honor. You made him ruler over the works of your hands. You put everything under his feet, all the sheep and oxen, as well as the animals in the wild, the birds of the sky and the fish of the sea that pass through the currents of the seas. Lord, our Lord, how magnificent is your name throughout the earth. And beginning in the first part of this, and this, of course, is a psalm of praise, the recognition of what God has done, and even questioning why he has done it. And so this is psalm of praise coming to God in recognition of him. And in verse 1 and 2 there, you know, O Lord, our Lord, how magnificent is your name throughout the earth. You have covered the heavens with majesty, or with your majesty. From the mouths of infants and nursing babes, you have established a stronghold on account of your adversaries in order to silence the enemy and the avenger. This idea of how magnificent everything that God has created. What a better time to recognize that than right now when you see everything blooming. You see this beauty that is surrounding us. Even thunderstorms, you know, when they come through and you just get this feeling of majesty because of the power that is involved in just this lightning strike and the clap of thunder and maybe just the roll of it through the air, and you think, there is so much power in that, and recognizing who made it, who designed it. We're getting to enjoy 4 baby foxes in front of the house. We get to watch them about every day now. I mean, if maybe around supper time and you sit there and you look out the window and they're out there and you know, they're kind of playing around and wanting, it's kind of like catch, you know, one of them go boing and bounce on the other one and they roll around. And of course, a vehicle comes by and they're right down back in the culvert. But then it doesn't take long to come out. Just the creation of things and the continuation of what God has set in place is amazing as we look around us. Springtime is wonderful, isn't it? I mean, to get to see all this happening again and to know that this is all part of God's creation. This is all part of his plan. I mean, we can take seeds and we can put them in the ground. I put a couple in the ground just yesterday. And hopefully something will come up from those and we'll see produce come from that. And it's interesting just to see how God has designed all of this. We look around us. We see the beauty of things. And I know I could open this up. Has anybody noticed anything that maybe they've never noticed before that they've seen it this spring? Or just something that has really stood out to you? Anybody? Quiet bunch this morning, huh? It just seems like coming out of, and to me, coming out of winter, it's like coming out of 2020, right? I mean, coming out of this long stretch to where we're seeing things that are around us. And if you haven't been seeing this, if you haven't been noticing what's happening in creation, look around when you walk outside today. Just look around a little bit and see what's happening. And it's God's design. And it's magnificent. You know, we try to recreate, I guess might be the word, things that God has done. I mean, John Pruitt is wonderful at what he can do with not only graphics, but in design of things like this right here. Isn't that marvelous? It's super neat. Is it as good as God's? No. Sorry, John. Just doesn't come close to God. It is fantastic. And after a week or so ago when I mentioned a pillar of fire, I think he's already working on that. So but it's amazing what we can do. I've been painting my office. We've cleaned out the offices because there's going to be new carpet put in the offices. So I've been cleaning on mine before I left in case things needed to happen while I was gone, and painted. And John walked in on Friday. I was up here. And John came in, and being an artist, I was just kind of expecting a response anyway. And he walked in and he said, "Oh." It's not what you want to hear when you're painting and you're close to done and you think you've done a fantastic job and it looks really good. Somebody walks in and goes, "Oh." I said, "You don't like it?" And he said, "Well, outdoors, woods, green and brown." And I said, "Yeah." And he said, "Well, we could have done some trees and we could have done this and we could have done all that, but I've got real animals hanging on the wall. I don't need fake ones, you know?" But sometimes we have to realize that regardless of what we can come up with, it's not going to beat what God did. We sometimes start doing that with life, with our own life, trying to fix our problems, or maybe even trying to fix somebody else's problems. We can work really hard at self-help, overcoming sin in our life, trying to make things right for maybe something that we did wrong. It's the same way. It's not going to be as good as what God did. He did it on a cross. He really did take care of it. So we look at what is around us. He has covered the heavens with His majesty. You know, I think it's pretty neat that Mr. Hubble was from Marshfield, Missouri, that now, you know, the Hubble telescope, and you can see things that you could never see before. You know, from that telescope that's out there, and we're seeing images of things that are just absolutely beautiful in God's creation that we couldn't see with the naked eye, and you couldn't even see from telescopes before that one was up there and floating around, and we can see now, and you wonder, why is that there? Why did God make that when we couldn't see it, you know, just with the naked eye, but we can see it now? Didn't God know that we'd eventually be able to see it? Sure He did. In His creation, what He has done is absolutely marvelous. Things that maybe we haven't even seen yet, maybe we haven't discovered yet, that we'll be able to see and we'll know there's nobody that could do that but God. This is reflected, and you can keep your finger in Psalm 8 if you want, but in Psalm 19, we're just right here close, so I want to turn over there in verse 1 and 2. It says, "The heavens declare the glory of God, and the expanse proclaims the work of His hands. Day after day, they pour out speech. Night after night, they communicate knowledge." The heavens declare the glory of God. They're talking to us. They're speaking to us. Day after day, they pour out speech. Night after night, they communicate knowledge. If you haven't done it recently, and you might, if you live in Springfield, I know you can't see the stars that good when you go outside because you get other light from the city and all of that. But if you get the chance, get out somewhere where there's no lights and just walk outside tonight. Look up if it's not cloudy. See if it doesn't talk to you. It's His creation. Back in chapter 8, or in Psalm 8, in verse 3 says, "When I observe your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars, which you have set in place." And then he comes with the question, who am I? When I observe what God has done. Now, hopefully, this is how it moves us to recognize that He is so magnificent, that He is so marvelous, that He is beyond our comprehension of words that can express who He is, that we have this response of, who am I? People don't always have that kind of response looking at creation. We should. Paul told the people at Athens when he got to speak to them, he said, God has made Himself evident through what He has created. In Romans, we see this description of that we have no excuse because we can see what God has created. He's made Himself evident. And that's what we're seeing here in this psalm and this recognition of who God is. In Matthew chapter 21, and we're still going to come back here to chapter 8. Or Psalm 8, if you want to keep your finger there. But in Matthew chapter 21, there was some people that recognized some greatness, but just recognizing it wasn't enough. In verses 15 and 16, I might well include verse 14 with that. Matthew 21, this is with Jesus. It says in verse 14, "The blind and the lame came to Him in the temple, and He healed them. When the chief priests and the scribes saw the wonders that He did and the children shouting in the temple, 'Hosanna to the Son of David,' they were indignant and said to Him, 'Do you hear what these children are saying?' Jesus replied, 'Yes. Have you never read? You have prepared praise from the mouth of infants and nursing babes.' Then He left them, went out of the city to Bethany, and spent the night there." They saw what Jesus was doing. They saw the miracles. They saw the blind see. They could see the lame walking again. And they recognized, it says they saw the wonders that He was doing. And yet what did they key up on? Do you realize what these kids are calling you? Do you realize that they're praising you? Jesus says, yeah, doesn't God talk about that? Their response wasn't good. People's response to creation and what is around us isn't always going to be good. Hopefully, the example of our response to it is right. In the psalm, he mentioned those mouths of infants and babes. Basically saying, God will use all things to declare His glory. It's interesting to me, and I don't want to move on without this part. But when he says in verse 3, "When I observe your heavens, the work of your fingers." You know, you look back at Genesis and you see creation, and God said, let there be. He just spoke it, right? We've talked about that here recently, just a little bit. But he just spoke it. But I like this idea of the work of your fingers. It goes a little bit more specific than the work of your hands, right? When you think about the work of your fingers. You ever watch a painter? I mean, not somebody who's painting an office wall. Have you ever watched a painter and watched their fingers as they paint? And how they maneuver the brush with their fingers? I mean, the detail that is there and that kind of thing. Anybody else used to watch Bob Ross? I mean, you know, everybody liked Bob Ross, right? You were ready to take a nap as soon as he was done. But just watching an artist work. You know, it's a different form. But if you ever get the chance, go visit John Pruitt. John, I'm sorry for saying this, while he's working. But to watch him take a photograph and put things there that aren't there, or take things out, create a reflection of a boat in the water that's not there. And to see how he does that with a click of a mouse and scooting things around and enlarging and decreasing and all of this, it's artistry. And to think, God did all of this. You know, we think, okay, we build things and we design things and we do all of that. We couldn't do any of it if he hadn't put it all together to start with. To make it possible for mortar to be made, or blocks, or trees that could be cut so that wood could be carved or sawn. And all of these things that we think that we create and we think that we do. He's designed it from the start. He's provided all of this for us. Just by the work of his fingers. Just to think what he's got in store following this. In verse 4, and this is quoted in the New Testament. It's talked about in Hebrews chapter 2. And I really like, it's interesting how he puts it here in this translation. What is a human being that you remember him? A son of man that you look after him. He says, you made him a little less, and I don't like the translation here where it says God, because that's not the word that's used. A little lower than the angels. It's also quoted that way in the New Testament. And crowned him with glory and honor. You know, we think about our response to God, and God, why would you even think about me? Why, when you can do everything that you've done, why, when you can design what you design, and just by the work of your fingers, you can make all of this, and you are so magnificent, who am I? You ever feel that way when you pray to him? Sure. You think, how can this be important to him? He is so far beyond this. You know, he took care of that. He gave the best example of showing that he does care by becoming one of us. He is interested. He even learned through suffering, is what Hebrews tells us. He is interested. He does want to know. He became like you and me, and he was tempted like we are. And so he relates. So he knows when you pray to him and you say, I'm sorry. Or when you say, please help me through this. I don't know if I can make it. He knows. And as magnificent as he is, beyond our comprehension, he still cares. because He's the one who's made us. He's the one who has designed us. What is man that you would take thought of him? He's God's image. He made us that way. In Hebrews, we see the reference from this psalm being applied to Jesus himself. Being made as a man, but just for a time. You know, we think about the angels. And you know, right now, I mean, angels can be before the throne in heaven, and they can also be here, right? And so that, we kind of look at that and we think, okay, that's a little bit greater than we are. And in all actuality, it's interesting because in our referencing that kind of thing, don't we go before the throne as well? Isn't that what Hebrews chapter 10 says? Have confidence to enter before the throne of God by the blood of Jesus Christ. So we enter before the throne too. We just don't see it except for the eyes of faith. You know, faith is the evidence of things hoped for, the confidence of things not seen. And so when we think about the angels and we think, okay, for a little while lower. But there's passages within Scripture, and I'm not gonna take the time necessarily right now to look at all those, but we see these passages. 1 Corinthians 6 in verse 3 says that we're gonna judge the angels. I don't know exactly what all that means. But it says he's in this conversation about, you know, taking each other to court and things like that, because the Corinthians were struggling with all kinds of things, and that was one of them. They were taking each other to court. It was almost like court was entertainment. Think about a culture that would have court as entertainment. Sorry if you watch it. But that's what it seemed to maybe have become to them. And he says, why are you going to outsiders to decide disputes between yourselves? Don't you have somebody who can decide disputes? And it's in that context that he says, don't you know that you will one day judge angels? Like I said, I'm not sure I fully understand what that means. But I believe it because he says it. So for a little while, lower than the angels, Jesus died for mankind. He didn't die for angels. What is man that you would take thought of him? We're the glory of his creation. He says here in verse 6, you made him ruler over the works of your hands. You put everything under his feet, all the sheep and oxen, as well as the animals in the wild, the birds of the sky and the fish of the sea that pass through the currents of the seas. So what is man that you would take thought of him? Well, man is the crown glory of your creation that you put in charge of everything that's here. Genesis chapter 1, it's real clear. Just like he's saying it here. I mean, the animals that move about and the things within this world and what we can do with it or what we decide to do with it. He's left man in charge to take care of what he has created. First of all, within the garden, but then even beyond that. I don't know if we always do such a good job. But the thing is, it's where he's placed us. In the process of taking care of his creation, hopefully we reflect his glory. That people see the glory of God through what he has left us to do. Praise team wants to come up, you guys can. And then he says it again, after talking about what God has done with mankind, after talking about what he has done with his creation, how he's used his fingers to design all of this, He says, Lord, our Lord, how magnificent is your name throughout the earth. So maybe just take some time. And it doesn't have to take time out of all of your other responsibilities, all the other things of life that you may be going through, to notice what God has done. Maybe from just a tiny blooming flower, or the clouds in the sky, or the stars at night. Or even better yet, just take a moment and look around at somebody else in here. Go ahead. Look around. We're like this, right? We look. I don't see anybody looking around. Look at the person next to you. God created them. God designed them. So if we're going to look at creation and we're going to think about how magnificent things out there in space that the Hubble telescope can see that we never could see before, and we look at it and we say that is absolutely beautiful, the crown glory of His creation is sitting right here. And somebody was looking at you. That means you too. He's not going to leave the crown glory of His creation alone. Aren't you glad He's our Father? Maybe you need to respond to this. Maybe you haven't been noticing what God has done. Maybe you've been thinking about all the things that you need to get done. My wife's coming home in a few days. I've really been thinking about all the things I need to get done. But you know what? Ultimately, everything that we think we need to accomplish is taken care of by Him. He accomplished it on a cross. So let's look forward to what He has in store for eternity now. See what else His fingers are going to do. If you need to respond to this, come as we stand and sing this morning.
Thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are.
Perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. To you'd please be seated. I'm filling in for Austin this morning. He and several of the young adults class are preparing for our picnic, our party of celebration here. In addition, I want to say that Sue Hughes and several people with her have worked tirelessly this week to prepare this little celebration for us. So we for sure want to thank her. And then also, while we're talking about this, as we go out to celebrate, Renee and Brian have spent many hours overseeing the insulation of the new floor. So I'd like to give them a little bit of thanksgiving for what they've done. So they worked as a good team over here every day of the insulation week, both morning and afternoon, several hours with the team, and actually grew close to the team that was putting in the floor, got to know them, invited them to church, et cetera. So it was very good. But in regard to what we're celebrating that everything we have, as Brad said in his sermon, with the he made the world, he made us, he made everything we have, he blesses us with jobs. It's all his anyway. The only thing that is our part is a test of what we're going to do with what he's given us, whether it be talents, whether it be finances, time, whatever it is. What are we going to do with what he's given us? That's the test. But it's all his anyway. And so just remember that as we think about, as we go by the offering plate, as we think about how we spend our time, as Brad said, as we have our to-do list, make sure that he's honored through that to-do list and how we spend our money and how we spend our time and our talents. So we're getting ready after we'll have an offering prayer here, and then we'll have a closing, and then we're going to go out and celebrate the blessing of the new floor. I know that Mike also has a VBS meeting, and where will that be held? Okay, VBS this year, we're going to have it the last full week of June. That Sunday is Father's Day, so we're not going to start Sunday night. We're going to do Monday through Friday evenings of that week, and Mike and Vicki are in charge of that. So today is the day that they want people to sign up and let them know who would be willing to assist so that they can start filling the jobs for that. But with this celebration, we first and foremost want to honor God for the blessing of what he's given us. And that's why we're doing it, not to praise ourselves or pat ourselves on the back, but to say God's richly blessed us, and we want to enjoy that blessing. So if you would pray with me. Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for this body of believers that you've called together, that we can work together and serve you here. Lord, thank you for the blessings, for the people who have poured into this body of believers in the past and are continuing to pour in now. Lord, help us to pass the test with you as to what we do with our time, our talents. It's all yours. Help us to acknowledge that, to understand it, and to give you the honor and praise and glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Do we have any other announcements? Okay, we'd like for you to join us for this last song, and then just continue the worship and fellowship outside and enjoying what God has blessed us with.
Come all you weary, come all you thirsty, come to the well that never runs dry. Drink of the water, come and thirst no more. God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only.
You're both like a